We are going to talk about that very, very obscure term, model law for electronic transactions. And it seems to be creating a small bit of wave in the various jurisdictions. And obviously, last year we did quite a lot. And this kind of stuff tends to happen behind the scenes. But it just gives you an idea that, you know, it excites quite a lot of people. And an indication of how seriously this particular topic is being taken is evidenced by what I would call as the awesome firepower that has been deployed in the panel. And we have two industry associations, we've got a bank, and we've got the World Trade Organization, just to give you an indication of how serious this is. But I'm not going to even try and introduce them because I don't think I can make a good fist of it, but let me start with inviting Emmanuel to introduce herself, if you don't mind. Emmanuel?
Sure, thanks, Bhaskar, and delighted to be joining you virtually. Unfortunately, I couldn't join in person. We're not allowed to travel yet, but I'm happy that I can join virtually. So for those who don't know me, I work at the World Trade Organization, which is the global body that deals with the rules of trade. So our objective is to facilitate trade, to make trade more efficient, more inclusive, to make trade work for ordinary people, as our DG says. And what do I do at the WTO? I have two hats. First, I try to make the life of small businesses wishing to trade internationally easier. So I lead work on macro, small and medium-sized enterprises. And second, I try to get trade officials excited about trade digitalization and blockchain in particular. So I do a lot of work on digital technologies and the potential of digital technologies to transform international trade. And in that context, of course, I've been doing a lot of work on Militar and trying to advocate for jurisdictions around the world to adopt Militar to accelerate trade digitalization.
Great. Thank you very much, Manuel. Todd, if you will.
Sure, thank you. I'm Todd Burwell, the president and CEO of BAFT. Some of you may already be members of BAFT. But we are an industry association with a focus specifically on trade finance and cash management. So we have members in about 65 different countries around the world, including several of the organizations here.
Great, thank you very much. Andre, if you will.
Thank you, Bhaskar. Hello, everyone. Nice to be here. My name is Andre Kassaman. I'm an independent consultant working since 6 years in the fintech space, working with half a dozen of highly specialized technology players, helping banks, not competing with banks. I've always worked for banks, actually, but never worked in a bank. My past is with Swift, so I've been on this stage talking about the Swift ICC innovations a few years ago. And delighted to be here representing ITFA, where we have a fintech committee gathering 45 fintechs, and some of which focusing a lot on the topic of the session, MLETR.
Great, thank you very much. Vishnu?
Yeah. Hi, I am Vishnu. I am the head of trade product for Emirates NBD Group, which includes the presence locations of Emirates NBD. So as part of my function, and the reason why I'm here is, as being one of the largest banks in the UAE, we are very much focused on how to bring digital solutions to our clients. So the panel today is quite an interesting topic for us and the work which we are doing in this direction. So, yep, happy to be here.
Great, thank you very much. Now, the reason why I said this is getting quite exciting is because I think this will this particular entire area of model law of electronic transactions is going to substantially change the infrastructure and the plumbing of international trade and trade finance. You heard from the previous treasurers who were talking about obviously the various aspects that are definitely part of their remit and things that they're worried about. Operational efficiency is one of the things that treasurers really, really crave for. That's what keeps them awake. That's what really irritates them. And anything that comes up to make it much more easier, faster, cheaper, and better is going to be good. So let me start by asking, and because we've got such a diverse panel, it'll be useful to have each of the panelists give their perspective on MLETR from their particular organizations, because It's a difficult concept to just pick up, and quite a lot of work has been done. So if I may start with you, Emmanuel, give us your thoughts about MLETR and the WTO and what it has done up till now.
Yes, so MLETR to me is a critical piece of legislation to digitalize trade. We need that legislation in place at the national level if you really want to digitalize trade. Why? Because key trade documents need to be able to be transferred when they are in electronic version, need to be able to be transferred across jurisdictions and recognized across jurisdictions. Now, international trade is a little bit like tango. You need to be two to tango, right? So you need the two trading partners to recognize electronic transferable records in order to really make a difference and allow trade digitalization to work. Technology is one thing, but it's only a tool. And what I often say is that code needs law. So you need adoption of the MLETR to truly move to the next level and make trade digitalization happen. Now, I think we are at a crossroad now. The pandemic has really shown that trade digitalization is not only a nice to have, but a must have. This being said, there's still some time to go, some journey. The journey remains long. If I can use an image, I think the MLETR train has left the station, but the journey remains long. UNC Trial with the MLETR has really created or built a nice engine to power trade digitalization. We've seen a few passengers coming on board, and that's very good news. There are 6 countries that have now adopted it. A few more are working on it. There is good momentum with the G7 statement that was issued last year. There is also a proposal in the context of the joint initiative on e-commerce at the WTO by the UK and Singapore to try and push on that front. The UK Law Commission is working very actively on it, and that could be transformational as well, because it will really be a big boost. It's estimated that 30% of global trade is under UK law. And so this could really benefit small businesses, and this is why we've been trying to push and advocate for trade digitalization at the WTO and for adoption of the MLETR at the national level. So these are very positive developments. I think we are really at a crossroads. I'm optimistic by nature, but I do think that we should not shout victory too early. As I said, the journey is still long. Most jurisdictions still have not adopted MLETR and still require paper-based documentation, trade documentation. So we need broader buy-in at the governmental level. Global adoption is critical, as I said. And I think we need to do more in terms of awareness raising. We've already done a lot. Different organizations have worked together to do a lot. But I think we need to do more to convince those who are not on board yet. And what I can see is that while, as you were saying, Bhaskar, there's a lot of awareness in the trade finance space on MLETR and the importance of MLETR, there are still many outside of the trade finance world that do not necessarily know much about MLETR. And not that long ago, a couple of months ago, I had a discussion with the trade chief of one of the WTO, key WTO members, and he didn't know what MLETR was, in spite of all the work that we've been doing over the past few years. So just to say that we need to do more in that space, and I think that all of you also have a critical role to play to lobby your governments, explain to your government officials what MLETR is and why it's so important for your business. So I'm optimistic. I think there's good momentum, but there's still much more work to be done.
Great. Thank you very much. And we will be delving into some of the points that Emmanuel has raised. But let me turn towards Vishnu, because I know the recent pilot that was done was pretty path-breaking. And you were neck deep into that particular pilot between ADGM and Singapore and a few other banks. So would love to hear your thoughts about MLETR and the pilot, please.
Great. Thanks, Dr. Bhaskar. So I think the way, as an organization, we have looked at digitization, which is not a new story, it's been going on for many years, but the way we look at it is very important that the end piece, which is a client, their journey is not disrupted. They don't have to sort of get involved into heavy tech setups, et cetera. So that's the core, as an organization, that we see from a digitization perspective when it comes to trade. What MLETR does is precisely provide that sort of a framework, is that clients hopefully will not have to go to different platforms, wait out which platform will be successful, do not have to invest in heavy tech infra. MLETR is the solution which will make, when we talk about interoperability of various systems, it would be perceived quite differently, because with MLETR, what we are talking about, an instrument, a paper which is used in trade finance, that itself being interoperable, that it can be used through any means of communication which is present. So if I would just summarize what MLETR means from a client perspective and from a bank perspective, is it provides a very frictionless framework on which first what can be built on is digitizing trade. And if I were to put it differently, make trade paperless and eventually make the instruments in such a manner which can also make the processes automated. So the first key step is making trade paperless, and I think MLETR is a very crucial step towards that direction.
Great, thank you very much. Andre, your thoughts, please.
So I think there is this key MLETR trend, and the model law was published in 2017. Some jurisdictions have adopted it, and the UK, as Emmanuel said, is going to be a key trigger, because the English law is key in global trade. But there is another development. I mean, Emmanuel said code needs law. I think that's right. And the technology world has progressed a lot. And cryptography in particular, together with blockchain, now enables basically to digitize the ownership of an electronic record, to digitize the transfer of ownership, to demonstrate the exclusive ownership of a particular electronic record. And this could not be done 10 years ago, unless you had a club structure where you agreed with a central database that that would be the custodian. Now technology, and again, it's mainly cryptography with electronic signatures, of course, but also blockchain, enables you to have an electronic record represented as a file that can be transferred between parties without all those parties being connected to the same platform. So really freely transferable documents. And that's what technology brings. And it's very recent technology in response to the MLETR, which is a legal framework, a legal requirement. So the two together now enables banks to serve their clients, indeed, in a very seamless fashion, so that there's no disruption. What they're going to see on screen is not just a scanned copy of a paper document, but is the actual original document, whether it represents a guarantee, a bill of exchange, or prom note. And the marriage of the two, the legal developments around the countries through the jurisdictions aligning with MLETR, together with the technology world bringing new technologies, and again, mainly cryptography, is very promising, because now banks can take advantage of those technologies to serve their clients in a fully electronic way. And we can go much further, because once you digitize those documents, you can organize, fraud protection, you can track the financing status of a particular instrument to fight double funding of specific instruments, or double use of specific instruments as a collateral. So this is an additional value proposition, but I think I want to highlight it, because for banks, this is sometimes the key to be protected from a fraud perspective, rather than the digitization, which is sometimes is seen as an intermediary step.
Of course, thank you. Todd, we spoke about quite some interesting pilots being done in the US as well. But from a BAFT's perspective and MLETR, would you be able to share your thoughts as to where does BAFT see an MLETR and its adoption?
Sure. So I want to take you back to 2017. We actually published a paper that was titled Code is Not Law. So that phrase isn't just kind of pulled out of thin air. But the story of the paper really revolved around three things. To achieve digitization, you need standards, you need interoperability, and you need a legal framework. Coincidentally, that year is also the year that UNCITRAL published the model law. So the working group that we had that was looking at that paper also was working on what we later published to be a distributed ledger payment commitment, or DLPC for short. What a DLPC is fundamentally is it's both a technical framework and a business framework that says if you want to do a payment commitment on a distributed ledger, it needs to have the following characteristics. And so we produced that paper in 2019. We had one of the fintech members of BAFT developed an application that essentially actualized the DLPC, and ultimately they conducted live transactions, which were originated on Hyperledger Fabric and concluded on Corda. So we proved the interoperability capability of this. It was constructed on the basis of Delaware law when it was done. And so what we have been doing since then is we've been working with the ICC and working with others to try to accelerate the adoption of legal framework in various jurisdictions. There's about six that have already adopted Meliter, but this is clearly going to be the longest road to hoe because every country's legal process is convoluted.
Well, before we go and talk more about what the national regulators and legislators need to do, let me go back to you, Vishnu, about and ask the panel as to what do the banks need to do to operationalize this? I mean, trade finance and especially transaction banking is replete with quite a lot of POCs which have been done, but a substantially lower number actually move into operation. So would love to hear the panel's thoughts as to what banks need to do to get this into operations, which actually then will start showing the benefits. So let me start with you, Vishnu.
So I think, first of all, it's a new initiative. It's a completely new thing which has come. So a lot of banks, what they have to do, first of all, is to start doing a lot of POCs to begin with, first, to make sure that they are comfortable. But from an operationalization perspective, there are solutions available which can be very easily integratable with their own legacy systems. So what is required is first to educate the clients that there is a solution which is available which can help digitize their trade finance completely. Because without the clients, there's no merit in operationalizing it. The tech part comes subsequently. The first thing which comes is there acceptability of a digital instrument by clients? So I think what banks need to do is focus a lot on first getting comfortable with MLETR as a framework, and also start to make their clients comfortable. And that's the way to go about it. Because technology, I believe, would come last. There are solutions available. It works beautifully well. And one of the reasons it works beautifully well is MLETR is a framework, is a law, which has made it so simple that it just tells you what would be qualified, what instrument, digital instrument, would qualify as a original equivalent of a physical documentation. It does not require too many things. So the key would be to build more awareness around this in their ecosystems, and I think that will be crucial for adoption of MLETR-related solutions. That's you.
Just as a personal anecdote, late last year I was speaking with a bank, and their head of operations had popped in to say, how can we make use of this? And because obviously identifying the use case to operationalize or even do a POC in a bank, there are so many options. And one of the examples I basically gave them was go through your list of complaints and moans that you're getting from your customers. Find out the person who's moaning the most and go to him or her and say, here's a potential option for you to resolve this. That kills off two, three things. One is it makes sure that your client who's obviously complaining about too much paper or turnaround times being not being good or whatever the case might be, and it actually tries to address a proof of concept and a roadmap to operationalization and directly solving a business problem that would help your business case as well. So that's one of the examples that that definitely help. But let me go back to Andre, your thoughts as to what do banks need to do to operationalize?
So basically, I often compare the technology required to digitize original documents, be it a bill of exchange, a prom note, a warehouse receipt, or and other documents potentially like guarantees. But to digitize an original document, what the banks require is a piece of technology that you can compare to electronic signature. Banks have integrated electronic signature technology since one or two decades for various processes, contract signing, payment approvals, and so on. And digitizing an electronic original is as simple as integrating an electronic signature technology. So that's a conceptual answer. So on the ITFA side, we saw this market trend coming 2-3 years ago, and we set up a working group to help the banks drive these efforts and to guide them to discover the technologies that are available to support electronic originals. And again, be it for guarantees or negotiable instruments. So we set up a digital negotiable instrument initiative, the DNI initiative, as part of ITFA that banks can join. There's no cost, of course. It's a kind of industry working group. And with thanks to that membership, they can interact with peer banks for, you know, avalization of bills of exchange, for instance, with some corporate customers that are also in that working group, but also with the big vendors, you know, the Finastra, the China Systems, the Shorecomp of this world, that are powering the trade back office, and that are gradually integrating that additional technology. The vendor we identified on the ITFA side to support this digitization of electronic of original documents is Enijo. So that's one technology provider today. But as this industry grows, I expect additional ones to, like you have seen on the electronic signature, you have DocuSign, Signicat, and a lot of vendors. So we see this industry growing. Integration of technologies is key, and this is happening since 2 years. China Systems was the first, Finastra was the second, and now the other ones are following on the banking side. And on the corporate side, you have Mitigram also doing it. I expect also additional corporate trade application to integrate the Enijo to digitize those documents. So we want to keep the existing technologies as much as possible. There's no need to change what is working. The front office, the back office, the channels, e-banking, SWIFT, all of that has to stay as is. The additional technology to be compliant with MLETR laws, like the Abu Dhabi Global Market, for instance, law, is really addressed by this Enijo technology as the first technology we have on the ITFA side to address those requirements. And for the customer experience point of view, indeed, it has to be as transparent as possible. So no need to join yet another platform. No need to join yet another ecosystem. There are too many ecosystems today. And our message is really to make this interoperability achievable at document level. A document, like a digital asset today, has to be interoperable across banks, across corporates, across platforms. So there is no need to force parties to join a particular platform in order to trade with a particular counterparty. So that platform mindset that we have seen over the past decade is an interesting one, but it has its limits. So I would put it in the 20th century kind of mindset, where in the 21st century, maybe it's only starting now, post-pandemic, but the digital asset world is something that is really on the blockchain indeed, is something that is really growing, that the regulators are embracing, and the trust is not only in the channel, but the trust is really in the electronic record. And that's the whole mindset of MLETR, and indeed technology allows to achieve it. Right. So really I invite banks to contact us, to join this working group, and to engage with some of the banks, like the one Vishnu represents, that are really keen on progressing technical POCs, business POCs, and engage with counterparties to get to a point where they can claim they are now ready for production.
Great, thank you. Todd, your views, what do your member banks that you would suggest should do to operationalize this?
Yeah, so I go back to what you said, because I think that's the start and the end, which is focus on the business problem you're trying to solve and solve that. And for each banks, it's going to be a little bit different. There are several banks that I think are sort of waiting for these different technologies to converge into one, market dominant solution. I say, don't wait, just start. You have to start, right? Digitize something. On the point of electronic signatures, what we saw was interesting was the pandemic really revealed where the wall was, right? Because in some instances, there is a legitimate wet signature requirement depending on the jurisdiction, right? Because in a lot of cases during the pandemic, people couldn't move. They couldn't go anywhere. Wet signatures was a real problem. In some cases, the issue was their own risk and compliance. And so banks had to focus on convincing their own risk management people that digital signatures and electronic exchange was acceptable. And I think that there was some progress that was made because of the pandemic. But when I come back to what should they do now, and you'll hear me keep saying standards, interoperability throughout the day, I think there's a couple things I've observed. One is, if you are going to build something new, make sure that it is not only scalable up, but that it's scalable down. Because so often I see that these proofs of concepts are built for the largest, most global corporation with the idea that this will ultimately trickle down. But it's almost like payments, where the toughest part of the payment is the last mile. The most difficult part of digitizing trade is going to be with the SMEs and the smallest companies. So if it's too difficult for a small company to adopt a solution, we're never going to get there. So make sure that the solution can scale. The other thing that I would say from a bank point of view is to engage in the advocacy process. So in order to actually get Melita adopted within a particular jurisdiction, we have to convince the government entities why it's in the interest of the country to digitize trade. It is not a given. So we really do need the banks to be part of that discussion and that dialogue.
Very good point. One of the things that what I found last year was whenever we were talking to banks, I particularly asked their lawyers, both the product lawyers as well as the corporate lawyers who were dealing with either the product legal side or on the contractual side, to come and speak to us so that they can get comfortable with the legislation that we had passed. Getting the backing, or at least not the obstruction from the lawyers inside the banking fraternity, is going to be huge. So one of the quick things that you can do to get things moving internally is to make sure that they are comfortable with the concept of MLETR. Emmanuel, if I may, I know you're looking at it from a supranational perspective, but obviously you have spoken to quite a lot of banks. From your perspective, what do you think would be the couple of things that banks can do to operationalize this?
Thanks. And I actually wanted to come back to the last point you made, which I think is critical, to have the lawyers talk to the techies, talk to the bankers, have all these people together and try to talk the same language and educate each other on what needs to be done. This is something that is very often lacking. We tend to still work in silo to a certain extent. And this has actually impeded, I think, trade digitalization. Now, a few points on your question. As other speakers have said, the tech is there. I think we now need to walk the talk. So what I would say to those banks that operate in a jurisdiction that is MLETR compliant is go for it, test it, make it happen, integrate the technology. That means really embracing the technology. As Andre was saying, we have Melita now to solve the double spending issue. Indeed, one of the key principles of Melita is singularity, because to become a fully and functionally equivalent to a paper-based transferable document or instrument, an electronic transferable record must be identified as the electronic transferable record to avoid multiple claims. And we've seen that there were some cases of fraud in Singapore because of that. So Melitar allows to solve this problem. And fulfilling this principle requires distributed ledger technology and cryptography, as Andrew was saying. That's what makes it possible to have one electronic record that is authentic. So what I would say to banks, to those who may still be hesitant, is go for it, and you better hurry up, because whether you like it or not, DLT is likely to be the future of digitalization to a large extent, so go for it. About the customer, and here I really like the point that Todd made. I work a lot with small businesses at the WTO, and they always complain about the complexity of trade procedures. It's not about banks telling them about the nitty-gritty of what will make a difference. What they need to know is, okay, how is it going to help me? Is it going to help me solve the issue, the problems I have? Will it reduce the paperwork I have? Will I be able to finalize my transaction quicker? This is really the narrative that banks need to have with their smaller clients to sell these solutions to them. Now, to those banks that are operating in a jurisdiction that is not MDR compliant, I would say, just like Todd said, go and lobby your government. Tell them about the importance of MDR, because as I said, I do know that quite a few government officials or trade officials are not fully aware of what MDR is and how critical it is for trade digitalization. But I would also say, don't wait for MDR to be in place. Go ahead and go digital, because otherwise it will be too late, and you may miss the train. It has already left the station, so go ahead and go for it. Now is the time to act.
Emmanuel, if I can stay on with you for the next question. I know all my colleagues over here have talked about how fintechs are an inextricable and very important part of the solution, because the wider fintech population can come up with potential solutions. So if you were to give one or two things or guidance to the fintechs on what they can do to take advantage of MDR, changing the business models, looking at things ranging from bills of lading to prop notes to supply chain finance products. What would you say from the fintech perspective? If a fintech founder or the CTO or the head of strategy is listening to this, what would you tell them?
Well, I mean, there are a lot of fintechs that are doing a fantastic job and developing very interesting solutions. Andre actually referred to a few of them. So I think, I mean, they're well versed into what the technology can do and how it can be used. One thing that I would say that I've seen in my interaction with actors in the field and fintechs in particular is that they all tend to have their own approaches and develop their own standards. And here's a point that that Todd made, and I very much agree with it. I think one thing that is very critical is when fintechs develop their solution, they keep in mind existing standards and use existing standards to make it possible to really have data move seamlessly from one platform to another, from one system to another, because this is really what is needed to digitalize trade. Now, I'm working very closely with the ICC DSI, the Digital Standards Initiative, to try and map existing standards. There are many organizations developing standards, be they sector-specific, international, or regional, or national. But so far, there's no real overview. And this is something in our interaction with the private sector that has been mentioned to us several times, is that it's difficult to know what's out there and how we can make best use of it. Why do we need to reinvent the wheel? So we are working on this standards toolkit to try and help drive adoption. It will be out in the next few weeks. And I really encourage not only fintechs, but also banks to look at it. It will cover identifier standards, standards for commercial transaction documents, standards for transport, standards for payment documents, etc. And I really call on you all, on banks, on fintechs and other stakeholders and actors in international trade to make use of existing standards to try and really make it easier for data to move seamlessly between the different systems. So stay tuned, it will be out very soon.
Thank you very much. I'm sure people will be looking forward to it. Todd, from your perspective, fintechs, what would you advise or guide them?
Yeah, so my own perspective, and my banking members may not like me saying this, I think fintech companies are far superior in operationalizing the technology's solution to the problem. They do it quickly, they excel at that. What I think they often underestimate is what it is going to take to scale their solution and to drive adoption. So I think the first thing I would say is get really, really familiar with the vetting process you are going to have to undergo in any bank, in any corporate, or any government entity that might use your system. Because it is long, it's extensive, and it can be quite painful to have to do it every single time you need to make a deal. And if you've only thought about the operational solution itself and not the cybersecurity concerns, not the fraud concerns, not some of the other vetting things that you're gonna have to consider, then you won't be able to scale. So focus on that. I would also suggest that when you're thinking about where do you place your energy, again, you want the solution to be scalable up and scalable down. One of the most difficult parts of scaling down is going to be digital identity piece. So if the solution needs some form of identity component, that's where you really need to probably spend a good amount of time making sure you've got a strong digital identity piece. And then the last thing is just what I've said, which is participate in the standards process, because ultimately your digital island is gonna need to connect to another digital island, and the best way to do that is to have familiarity with standards or to help define the standards so that everything you build fits with it.
Great, thank you very much. Andrew, of course, you have now created, if I may call it, as an ecosystem where you've got both fintechs and banks working towards this. And with your experience of dealing with quite a lot of fintechs who are working in this area, what would you say to the fintechs to help them operationalize the model law?
It's really about finding their niche. So really specifically on the model law, we definitely are trying to digitize existing flows. The instruments I referred to earlier exist today. We believe through digitization, those negotiable instruments will become more attractive because the higher convenience of those bills of exchange from notes will make them more attractive, and hopefully the volumes for banks will grow. And for the fintechs themselves, they need to assess their current role in the trade ecosystem. Are you a corporate multi-bank platform like Metagram? Are you a back office vendor like Finastra, China Systems, Surecomp? And how can you embrace this MLETR, the new laws that are aligning with MLETR, reinforcing your high degree of specialization in the trade ecosystem? Our proposition, having worked through the ITFA D&I initiative since mid-2019, so it's going to be soon 3 years. Today, our response is we found a document technology provider called Enigio that addresses these MLETR requirements. So we have worked with those different vendors for them to integrate that Enigio technology, but the trade ecosystem doesn't change. It's still the same vendors, still the same process, still the same instruments, but more and more on an electronic way, in an electronic way, rather than on a paper-based or half electronic, where the original paper is digitized into a copy. So reinforcing their degree of specialization in trade is what MLETR allows them to do. And I would add that the law firms are the ones who will be critical as a next step, because as banks discover those technologies, and we're working already with a dozen of banks to introduce those technologies, but as banks discover, appreciate the benefits of the technology and so on and want to move into production, they will want a legal opinion from law firms. So the law firms have a huge opportunity in their legal advisory role and in also indeed guiding the banks to make sure that those electronic records, whether they are based on the one or the other legal framework or the one or the other technologies, will be enforceable Because at the end of the day, if the banks don't get legal opinions on those additional technologies we are introducing, they will not dare moving into production. So that's really the end goal, to guide the banks in discovering those technologies, to help them move into production. And that's why we are working with a number of law firms today, because they will offer the, I would say, acid test for banks to go into production.
Great, thank you very much. Vishnu, you obviously have got a unique perspective on this because you are at the end of the line for the fintech as a user or as a buyer, and perhaps both roles are quite important. So from your rather interesting perspective of being a user of what the fintechs would provide, and with your vast experience in this area dealing with fintechs, what would you tell them as to what would appeal to you? Well, what would you like? What are the things that they could do? And I know you've heard from Todd and Emmanuel and Andrea on their perspective, but from the banking perspective, would love to hear views, please.
Certainly. I think what is most important from a tech solution perspective is that it has to be very, very simple for clients to access it. Todd mentioned earlier that it has to be accessible to all. I mean, it has to touch the entire spectrum. The solutions cannot be built for larger corporates or larger banks who are very tech savvy. So while we have come a long way in terms of MLETI compliant solutions, we have NGO, we have Trade Trust Framework and various fintechs working around it. But at this point of time, it is still a little bit of overwhelming. Why I say that is because as individuals, we are used to of using tech in a very simple fashion. It is not unreasonable to expect that as corporate users, we should have technology which is invisible completely. So what I mean by that is the focus should be on creating a solution where the users don't have to take care of a lot of stuff. For example, Trade Trust, users have to create, let's say, a MetaMask wallet. That's something which is completely new to corporate users. Why should that be a requirement? Or for documents which are on using a crypto technology to establish document provenance, how can we further simplify that they don't have to manage their key pairs of the documents? At this point of time, I have a physical document. I keep it locked in my drawer, and it is safe there. Worst case scenario, I lose the key of the drawer, but once I break open the drawer, I have all my documents there. But of course, fraud is an important aspect, and for that, the relevant document key pairs, the cryptography technology is important, but it has to come out in a manner that it is very simple for the end consumer to adopt. It need not be overwhelming. And I believe with more experimentation, we will reach at a point where creating a digital document using which are MLETI compliant should be a pay-per-use kind of a service. Why cannot we reach that particular point? And when I mentioned earlier, it should be accessible to all. An interesting point which Todd mentioned earlier is having digital identities. I think that is a very, very crucial component. Because at this point of time, what is required is, if there is a solution, you need somebody to give you an entry into that solution. And that's where people are in the waiting and watch game, right? So it is very interesting and ironical that in the entire trade transaction, the signatures are verified only at very few points, which is when, let's say, if I were to take example of an exporter, they're submitting their presentation to their bank. Only the bank sees who is authorized to sign. And when the importer's bank makes a presentation to their buyer and they give the acceptance, it is only at that point of time that they see who is authorized to sign. As a bank, do I really verify who is the shipping company who signed? Of course, I do some IMV checks, et cetera, and all those things. But once the entire document is digitized, I know this is the original instrument. So no one really cares actually who at which point of time has signed. It is only the banks, and banks have the mandates that need not be reinvented. So can we have a digital identity ecosystem which is as simple as creating a social media profile, but then comes the question of fraud, right? Then we have concepts as individual users which we're exposed to is having a verified identity. So what I mean by that is today banks are sitting on a crucial piece of information which is KYC of all the corporates. Can there be a tech solution which is linking ultimately to make the MLETI compliant solutions accessible is how can customers go and create their profiles, get it verified, which should give them entry into accessing the solutions that will come up in the future. So to summarize, I think it has to be something which is very simple to understand. It should not be overwhelming, and it should not be dependent on somebody that, okay, I first have to get on board to something, partner with somebody. It should be a utility, and I hope that it will be someday, that if, as an individual user, I want to create a digital equivalent of a physical document, I can go and pay for that one document and actually go about my business. Because the customers at the lower spectrum will not be otherwise be able to benefit, which is where the most significant the benefits lie of trade digitization. So we have to think from the customers who do not understand technology very well, from their perspective, to really unlock the benefits which we generally speak about when we talk about digitizing trade.
Oh, that's great. Thank you. Now I'd like to return to something that both Emmanuel, Todd, as well as Andre had mentioned, that trade finance obviously is a business which relies on trade corridors. And it is absolutely vital that more and more jurisdictions adopt this mechanism, because until and unless you've got these trade corridor pairs that are on the model law, so to say, you cannot really expand the benefits further. So one, obviously, which you heard, that there are six jurisdictions who have already signed up for it. One pair of jurisdictions, that is ADGM and Singapore, did the pilot. Andrew mentioned about the progress that is being made in the UK, which is obviously one of the large hubs. Todd also mentioned that, you know, quite a lot of industry advocacy is important. We all need to get behind this particular mechanism. But let me start with Emmanuel, because given the fact that this is a global thing and more people can join, that'll be good. And of course, there are challenges. Let's spend the next few minutes trying to ascertain what can be done, what are the issues, what are the challenges, and you can see the perspectives of each of the panel members. So, Emmanuel, if I may, I think you are best placed to give us an indication of what you are seeing from a supranational perspective as to what are the countries doing, what are the challenges, what can be done to improve. Give us some views on that, please.
Said on that particular issue, we need a global approach. Digitalizing some trade corridors is great. It's a very good first step, but we actually need to go further. Otherwise, some people will be like behind, and we'll have a split world with some haves and some have-nots. There are some talks about the splinternet. We could have a splinter trade if we don't really have that global approach. So global commitment is clearly very important, and this is where I believe fora like the G7, the G20, or organizations like the WTO, the ICC can play a role, and we are trying to be active in that field. Another thing that I would say is that it's important to have a cross-sectoral approach and to go beyond one specific sector. I know a lot is happening in the trade finance space, and this is great. What I believe is important is to conduct pilots that go beyond the trade finance world and that touch upon different sectors, because this is how we will really move towards greater trade digitalization. The third point is a greater education, awareness raising, or even technical assistance to those developing countries, less advanced developing countries, or least developed countries that do not necessarily know what MELIDAR is or how to go about it. And we've seen with the UK example that it's not necessarily straightforward to adopt the MELIDAR because there can be some concept that exists in the legislation that make it a bit tricky. In the case of the UK, it was the notion of possession that is attached to a tangible asset. So what do we do when it's an intangible asset, an electronic document? So they had to play with that and to use the notion of control of an electronic document that then means possession of that electronic document. Now, UNCTRAL is doing a fantastic job in that respect, but I think if you really want to have a global movement, we also need to accelerate work in terms of education and awareness raising. A fourth point that I would like to make is that there are a lot of talks about Militar, rightly so, because it's a very important piece of legislation, but let's not forget e-signatures. They are critical to digitalized trade, and as a matter of fact, we're not there yet. I mean, there are still many jurisdictions that do not have legislation when it comes to e-signatures and recognition of e-signatures. So here again, I think this is something to bear in mind. And the fifth point and last point that I would like to make, I said earlier, code needs law, so Militar recognition of e-signatures, but code also needs standards, as we said with Todd. And I think it's very important that we also move together on these with the different stakeholders being involved in the different initiatives to develop standards, to try and fill existing gaps and to promote adoption of standards. Data models for trade documents, but also rule books for the different platforms. So I think these are the five points that I would like to emphasize that I see as needed if we really want to move and accelerate trade digitalization.
Great, thank you very much. So Todd, if I may, I know you were quite passionate about getting your members engaged in the awareness and advocacy piece. Give us some thoughts as to especially jurisdictions which are either one end of the trade corridor, which is not signed up to MLTR, or where the conversations are happening. And I know the G7 and other people have talked about. Give us some thoughts as to sort of, you know, this international cooperation and the importance and how to go about doing this.
Yeah, and I probably should have started all of my comments this way to tell you that these are my thoughts and comments, not that of my members. In particular, it's important because I'm sure some of the things I'm going to say now are not going to be very popular. So difficult jurisdictions. I mean, we're trying to do a lot of work right now in the U.S., for example, right? And there's a couple of streams of this. One is with eSign. You were talking about digital signatures. There is an eSign law in the U.S. that we were looking to get amended to incorporate certain types of trade transactions. And just the legislative process in the United States right now is enough to, you know, make someone retire. It is very difficult to get laws changed there. So I think that there's going to be jurisdictions like that where it will take a long time. So we have to get the wins where we can get the wins. When I was actually speaking with a technology company earlier today and realized that some of what I may have said may sound contradictory, and I want to clarify it. So where I think organizations like BAFT and industry bodies need to spend our time focusing on standards is I look at that as trying to deal with the destination being a fully digitized ecosystem, and what do we need to achieve that and work backwards. And what I think the banks and the fintech companies should be heavily focused on is meeting clients where they are today and taking them forward. So helping them to adopt the digital tools that are available, we will ultimately meet in the middle. Now, the one thing that has perhaps caused me a little bit of pessimism is I think of this journey as somewhat of an obstacle course. And Militar is kind of like that wall in the back of the room that you realize after you get through all these obstacles, you're going to have to climb that big wall, right? But what I think I'm realizing now is that there's actually something else on the other side of that wall that we haven't thought about, which is data privacy, and you know, the sharing of data and open data movements. Because there are geopolitics that come into play when it comes to sharing data, and that is just going to be a reality. So I think once we clear that wall to really deal with this on an international level, we may first need to take a regional view of it. So looking at regional trade agreements where we can align the laws within that regional trade agreement, align the data privacy laws and sharing within that regional trade agreement, and then I'm going to have to leave the work up to Emmanuel to help us get all these regions together, because I think there will be some challenge in getting through the geopolitics point of this.
Yeah, that's a fair point. Andre, your thoughts, international cooperation.
Yes, I mean, the UK, so what we've seen so far, 2017, indeed, the publication of MLETR. Bahrain was the first country to align with MLETR or adopt it, then Singapore, and then Abu Dhabi Global Market. We worked together on that. And now the UK is expected to indeed align with MLETR. That means integrating the concepts to enable these negotiable instruments to offer a digital option. So that one is a major one because it's going to be the first G7 country, if I'm not mistaken. And we know the English law represents maybe 30, 50. If anyone has an official figure, I'm interested to know of the volume of global trade. English law, together with US law, is another big legal system, of course. So that will have ripple effects on other jurisdictions that will say, we have to do the same. There's a bit of peer pressure, but there is also reinforcing the MLETR adoption trend. But it will also enable, indeed, banks around the world trading on the basis of English law to benefit from MLETR, even if their country has not made the move, indeed, for the local trade. So a major step we are expecting to be completed by Q3 of this year. That's up to the Law Commission working with the Parliament, and ICC UK being a major also of driving force in this local effort. In the meantime, we are also on the ITFA side engaged with banks in France, in Germany, as major countries where I see really commitment through different associations like ICC and the local banking associations, of course, to engage with their local regulators to change the law. Oh. So I expect, indeed, additional countries to at least identify the gap that they need to fill in order to align with the MLETR. Sure. Because sometimes they can already do it on some instruments, but not yet on other instruments. So we leave it to the legal experts to tell us where is the gap and how to engage with the policymakers to fill the gap.
Now, I should point out one small thing, that whilst all this conversation is obviously around English common law, it's not like that the non-English common law, the case law people have not been looking at. I would particularly point out the case of Germany, where some very, very interesting initiatives in this particular area have been taken up. And it's proving to be not an impediment to passing the model law. Final thoughts, Vishnu.
So on, I think from a bank perspective, since we are an important stakeholder in the ecosystem, what each of us have to do is bring more players on to start participating in the POCs which are going on. It is very important to have, and I have been saying this in all my points, is to have the customer's acceptability. So banks should get comfortable, and I think they should start having those dialogues with their clients, especially in the jurisdictions and countries where the equivalent of MLETR is already present, and start doing some real transactions so that the world takes notice of it, that it is indeed possible to digitize trade with very minimal effort when it comes to from a technology perspective. So that's where it is. I think whatever the components we have in place already, they have to be leveraged to the fullest extent possible. And I think it's a call for action. There's no need to further sort of wait for other simpler solutions to come into picture. We will reach a point wherein it will be very easy to sort of do digital trade. But if we don't start now, as Emmanuel mentioned, I don't see we getting into any better position from where we are right now. So to the extent possible, get the ecosystem players to start participating in the POCs. And specifically in the corridors like UAE and Singapore, to have cross-border trade as well, that would be very crucial.
Okay, great. I think we are bang on time, and I think we've got a few minutes. So
good. I have a few questions that came in on the app, Oscar.
Fantastic.
Yeah? We shoot. And the first one is, we've heard a lot about digital islands and interoperable standards. What are these standards that people are referring to?
I think perhaps Andrea and Todd might be well placed to answer those. So, Andrea, do you want to take
Yeah, indeed. So those platforms we have seen growing are definitely relevant because they're adding value. They're offering applications, multi-banking applications, or agreeing on multilateral rules. However, we have seen that there are so many islands or platforms that it's creating an operational burden on corporates or banks to have to connect to multiple of those, like banks having to connect to multiple of those to support their own clients. So with the digital asset technology we have today, which is based on blockchain, we can now transfer transactions from one platform to another and make those platforms interoperable at the level of the transaction, at the level of the data set. And that technology is again based on the same technology we positioned for the negotiable instruments. One example is the Enigio technology. Does not require point-to-point solutions to be developed because point-to-point solutions are not scalable. Here we now have a common technology that can be integrated by multiple platforms in the same way as is being implemented by multiple banks that need to exchange bills of exchange for avalization amongst themselves.
Very good, very good. That's really helpful, Andre. Next question I have here is, we heard this morning from Dubai Chamber that 100% of their certificates of origin are now issued electronically and are acceptable by customs at nearly 100%. What would the MLETR add to that certificate of origin?
What is the question?
Dubai Chamber certificates of origin are all issued digitally now.
Yep.
And the point is that they're accepted almost universally by customs around the world.
Would the MLETR
add value to that process? Or I know you're thinking more about trade finance, but that's the question.
I'll take that one.
Yeah, please.
I think when we speak about MLETR, what we're talking about is transferable records. What I mean by that is like a bill of exchange or a bill of lading, where it is not just one party or an institution that has issued a document and it remains in that state forever. So a certificate of origin or an invoice are instruments which are issued and that's it. They don't require any further transfer. So MLETR is going to more impact those kind of transactions, documents which need to be transferred. So the law provides what digital document, what version of the digital document can actually be taken as a functional equivalent of a physical transaction, that who is in control of the digital document, who can transfer it. So certificate of origin is not a document which should actually be touched upon by MLETR. Sure.
Wonderful answer as well. And I think this is a follow-on question. The last one, I think it's a follow-on from the same person. The electronic transaction law came into effect in the UAE on the 2nd of January 2022, and it recognizes the functional equivalent of a paper record or document, and it also recognizes electronic signatures. And similar to the last time, it's a trickier question, what value the MLETR will bring to that? Because if it was issued, if we have a paper bill of exchange and you have electronic under the UAE law, it should be recognized as the functional equivalent and not lose its legal validity.
So you want to take that
one?
Okay.
Tricky one.
Okay, so I'm not sure if I got the full question right, but I think the answer lies in the fact that when we are talking about a functional equivalent, what we are trying to achieve, or rather what MLETR is trying to achieve is electronic record is as good as a physical document. The two documents are not actually working in tandem.
Yeah.
So what MLETR does is it's a supplemental law to the existing laws that are prevailing in the countries, right? So if you were to create a document using the framework which MLETR provides, it is then recognized as good as a physical document. It does not have to sort of work in tandem. So I'm not sure if I got the question fully right.
You got, by just reading the thing here, the question here is, under the new electronic transactions law, there will not be any discrimination against a document because it's in electronic form. It will not lose its legal validity because it is in electronic form. So if it was a bill of exchange...
That's a primary essence of the law, right?
Yeah,
exactly. Yeah.
So the whole objective of MLETR is to say that the digital version, actually, digital version is not the right term to be used. The digital document is fully legally enforceable.
Okay.
So it provides for that framework. In no way it can be discriminated between a physical, there can be discrimination between a physical.
But that's what the electronic transaction law also states. Just, you know.
Okay.
Yeah. but a very good answer, a very good answer. Any final question from our audience?
Because
that's my full three.
So Vince, if I may, just to kind of add on, because I'm not an expert in UAE law, but I think to simplify this, if I own this bottle, right, the question is, if this bottle now breaks, who owns this bottle and who's responsible for it? And if we transfer this bottle and we sort of pass this bottle around the stage, does ownership of this bottle transfer? And if so, when? How do you evidence that? How do you prove it so that when we have to go to a court to figure out who broke the bottle and who's responsible? Yeah. That's what the framework, the legal framework, has to support.
Very helpful, very helpful. Any, we have a question.
Can I jump in?
David.
Better, here we go. Really great panel, guys, and great conversation. And very important topic, given there's still 4 billion documents that facilitate trade today in the world, so we need to work on that as a industry, I think, to break that down. A lot of attention on the Saudi market right now in this event, a lot of activity, a lot of volume, and a lot of initiatives around facilitating frictionless trade in the kingdom. Can you give us an update on Saudi, on adoption of these frameworks and Unicitral model law.
Great. Let me pass it on to my colleagues. Any thoughts? I know the eKYC pilot did help, and to a certain extent it does give evidence that there was some work being done on the identity side. But let me ask my colleagues if they have any comments on this. Emmanuel, do you have any thoughts on the Saudi side?
Actually, not on the Saudi side. I was going to intervene on a couple of other points that were made on the previous law. One of the key principles that has to be in the legislation so that legislation is MELITA compliant is the question of the principle of singularity. To really prove that the electronic transferable record is the original electronic transferable record. So it goes back to the notion of possession that Todd was mentioning. And I also wanted to briefly come back to the question of standards, the very first question that was asked. There are different types of standards that matter. So you have some technical standards and Ray addressed that, but you also have some standards in terms of the data models for trade documents. And this is critical for trade digitalization. And here we're talking, for example, about standards for bills of lading. So there's a standard, the DCSA issued a standard last year for the container bill of lading, but we're still missing a standard, for example, for the bulk and dry bulk bill of lading. And this is where there's more work also that needs to be done, and what we're doing with the ICC, trying to map those different standards that exist. Why? Because we need to make sure that people, the two trading partners, understand what means what, have the same understanding of the meaning, but also that data is entered in the same way so that it can move from one system to another seamlessly. So there are different dimensions to this discussion on standardization, and I think both are very important to keep in mind. Thanks.